Take these hands, lift them up, for I have not the strength to praise you near enough, for I have nothing, I have nothing without you. Take my voice, pour it out, let it sing the songs of mercy I have found, for I have nothing, I have nothing without. Oh, my soul needs is all your love to cover me, so all the world will see that I have nothing without. Take my body, build it up. May it be broken as an offering of love. For I have nothing, I have nothing without you. Oh, my soul needs is all your love to cover me, so all the world will see that I have nothing but I love you. With all my heart, with all my soul, with all my mind, all the strength that I can. Take my time here on this earth. Let it glorify all that you are worth. I have nothing, and I am nothing without. Thank you.
Amen. Friends, we welcome you in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ to St. Paul Presbyterian Church. We are so glad that you're with us this Sunday morning, and we invite you to take time to note and pay attention to our e-blast. I know we're all busy, but it always highlights the weekly and monthly activities that are going on. There have been opportunities to serve this past week. We have had our CCSC service at Gethsemane St. Luke's United Methodist Campus. We had 4 to 5 of our members go out, and they serve with River Oaks Baptist. And we are so grateful that this past Saturday, from 8:45 until 12, meeting the needs, reaching out. Also, Church Under the Bridge, we are preparing for the fall. And you are invited to bring socks, to bring hats, caps, as well as blankets. At the back of our sanctuary, there's a basket, a gray basket, and we have Katrina Kirby, who's overseeing this, with Verita Duncan, and they will collect in these coming weeks and then provide those needed materials for those that are transitioning and on the streets. Your giving makes a difference. Also, I want to remind you that there is always weekly opportunity for midweek fellowship. We have Christian Women's Fellowship that is on Monday evening through Zoom. Please join if you've never been a part. We also have Presbyterian Women's Circle, and that is offered in regards to 2 active, if not a 3rd, starting. Pay attention to when you can maybe make time to join one of those groups for nurture. And we're hoping mid-fall to be offering more regarding for our men's support as well as opportunities coming up in Advent. We are grateful that this fall, as we start, there is so much activity you will hear about for building our new church campus and the ways in which God is working in and through St. Paul family. We also have a special announcement that Sharon Carey will come forward now at this time and share a few thoughts. Sharon?
I know many of us in the congregation use a devotional that we bring out every quarter called These Days. How many of you read These Days? Yes, several. This morning I was just touched by how the message today hit for our congregation. In 2017, we sold our church property that had been for over 50 years on Bel Air Boulevard and started the journey toward building out in an area that had many, many families and homes that needed to have a church and have a congregation in their lives. It has taken us, as you know, until now to be able to say we have exactly what we need. And that's been through prayer, lots of prayer, and God leading us through some really stormy times. Today's meditation comes to us referencing Jeremiah 32, but it talks about how God's providence is confidence that God will bring about a good ending in spite of our present upheaval. And this I'm going to offer to you as a prayer, where God might be calling us to invest in a promised divine fortune is where our heart should be. Are there desolate places where God intends to bring about new life? Places where God wants us to put a stake in the ground so that we can participate in a beautiful rebuilding? God of new life, help us, St. Paul Presbyterian Church, to trust your salvation story. Show us where and how you want us to invest in a flourishing future for your people. Amen.
Amen.
Sharon, thank you for sharing those thoughts that remind us God is working in and through the transitions we are going through. Friends, this is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it.
Call to worship. Stand if you are able to. Let your compassion come speedily to meet us, for we are brought very low.
Help us, O God of our salvation. Deliver and forgive our sins, for your name's sake.
Let us worship God. Let's pray. Give up every good and perfect gift. Your steadfast love endures forever. You redeem the nations from distress and trouble. You gather your people from the corners of the earth. We enter your courts singing thanksgiving for the bountiful mercies you lavish upon us. Hear our glad praises and be pleased with our worship, for you are worthy of all honor. Amen.
Amen.
Please be seated. Call to confession. The Lord is near to the brokenhearted and saves those who are crushed in spirit. Let us admit our sins before God. Let us pray together the prayer of confession, saying, Merciful God, lead us by the course of compassion. We seek your forgiveness through Christ's intercession. Fill us anew with your Holy Spirit so that we may faithfully obey your will. When we are vengeful, purge our thoughts of resentment and anger. When we bear false witness, turn us from deceit to truthfulness. Cleanse us of all selfish desires. Holy, in righteous righteousness. Amen. Assurance of pardon. God as Savior desires that all should be saved and come to the knowledge of the truth. There is one God and one mediator, Christ Jesus, who came as a ransom for all. With assurance and conviction, I say to you, God in Christ, forgive us our sins.
Now time for the children's message. Our young disciples, come forward. Those young at heart are welcome as well. Come join me and let's take a seat up here. Some of our children back there would love to have you.
So good to see you all this morning. I am so glad that you were all gathered because, you know what, this Sunday we're going to hear about prayer. What do you think prayer is? Any ideas? Yes, yes, you talk to God. What else do you think prayer is?
Be nice.
Be nice, that, I like that too.
Praying to your Father.
Yes, praying to God our Father. Y'all, very good answers. We're going to hear from 1 Timothy chapter 2 that we need to pray in a certain way all the time. And you know what that is? We pray for others, for all people. Do you pray for all people? I think what we try, but most of us kind of pray for ourselves and pray for our brothers or sisters if we have them, our mother or our father. We pray for maybe a friend, but praying for strangers, people we don't know or see, we're not always real good about praying all the time for them, are we? So I want you this week to think about this. Pray for one person you don't know well. Maybe they're in your class. Maybe it's a teacher you don't know. Maybe it's praying for your principal. Pray to God, our Father, to pray that they will be with God, they will know God, and the scriptures call it, we pray for their salvation, that they would know the love, grace, and truth of God. Will you make it a prayer this week? Think about it for one person you don't know. And therefore, we're hearing the word, pray for all people. Amen. Pray with me now. Let's pray together. Say after me and let's pray. Thank you, loving God, for your love. Help us to pray for all people. Amen. Thanks for sitting with me. At this time, we are going to have a special announcement and presentation that will come forth from our building committee. I know you're anxious to hear what's going on with our new property and development. So we will have Nelson Kalu come forward, as well as April Dixon. And there will also be an update from staff committee from Nelson.
Good morning, church.
Good morning.
Good morning. We are excited to bring you the update on the building committee. While we are planning to have a congregational meeting where we will give more information, there's some other stuff we are waiting for, like financing and all those things. While we are waiting for that, we thought that we'd let you know where we are since our last announcement. We have had two meetings with our architect and the builder. And as of yesterday or Friday, they've given us an update on the concrete, what I call concrete building schedule. All things being equal, we're supposed to break ground first week of December, December 5 to be exact. However, we are hoping that we can break down earlier than that. Also, we asked them, we want this to be completed within a year. And the tentative that they've given us, if all things fall in place the way they're planning it, is December 11th, 2023, when we'll move into the church. However, we are also hopeful, like I told them, it will be great if we can have our Thanksgiving in that church. So, your building committee is working very hard, making sure that we put everything in place. Right now, April is working with our attorney, John Tyler, in trying to get the final wording on the contract so they can sign the contract. Once we get all this contract signed, hopefully by September 26, everything should be on the go. So that's what I wanted to update you all on. And like I said, in a few weeks, we will have a congregational meeting. We are hoping to have more information to bring to our church members. Thank you very much. At this time, I'll let April say a few words on the building also. She's an integral member of that committee, especially looking over our contracts. When the contracts come up, because she's a paralegal, so she spends a lot of time looking over it before we send it to the attorney. April.
God is good. All the time, God is good. So we have a new contract before us, and the 26th is our target date to have it signed by. So the sooner we get it signed, the sooner things can move on. Waiting on the permits to wrap up for the last little bit and then break ground in December. Hoping to have the labor and the materials to get that started. We thought that steel delivery was going to be a long lead time. It's the same 12 weeks, so they can go ahead and it's not going to delay things like we had thought. So moving right along towards December 2023, and a little sooner would be lovely. Agreed. Very exciting to be part of the building committee and those things. So while we're working with Clarence the architect, and Judd Coward with Aeromont Constructors, the design build services operations side. We're also, the other side of the house is working with Claire Lewis for Presbyterian Investment Loan Program. The idea is to get them the materials that they've requested, so that's in process right now. So, you know, it's all about all these moving parts coming together. So the building committee is really requesting your prayers for all those things to come together so we can see our way through this transition time. So pray for us. Back to Nelson.
Please join me in prayer. Gracious God, prepare our hearts and minds to hear and to receive your word for our lives today. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Our first scripture reading is taken from Psalms 113. Psalms 113. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord, you, his servants. Praise the name of the Lord. Let the name of the Lord be praised, both now and forevermore. From the rising of the sun to the place where it sets, the name of the Lord is to be praised. The Lord is exalted over all the nations, his glory above the heavens. Who is like the Lord our God, the one who sits enthroned on high, who stoops down to look on the earth, on the heavens and the earth? He raises the poor from the dust, and he lifts the needy from the ash heap. He seats them with princes, with the princes of his people. He settles the childless woman in her home, and as a happy mother of children. Praise the Lord. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Amen. Thank you for that. I invite you to read along with me for our second scripture reading. It's taken from 1 Timothy chapter 2, verses 1 through 7. Hear these words that challenge us to be prayer warriors, to be those mindfully praying for our world all the time. It's an amazing challenge and call for all believers, not just for few, but for all to hear these words about prayer. I urge you then, first of all, that requests, prayers, intercession, and thanksgiving be made for everyone, for kings and all those in authority, that we may live peaceful and quiet lives in all godliness and holiness. This is good and pleases God, our Savior, who wants all men and women to be saved and to come to a knowledge of the truth. For there is one God and one mediator between God and men and women, and the man Christ Jesus, who gave himself as a ransom for all, the testimony given in its proper time. For this purpose, I was appointed a herald and an apostle. I am telling the truth. I am not lying. And a teacher of the true faith to the Gentiles. The word of the Lord for our daily living. How many of you think that you might have a bit of a twang? Have you ever heard that expression in Texas, of all places? Some of us from other countries, some of us who were born here, some of us from other parts of the world. You don't have a twang now, do you? The twang is surprising. The twang, the dialect, the accent that can emerge from living where you live. It's influencing. It creeps up. It gets your attention as you start settling into the culture, maybe the second culture or the third culture you're a part of. But today, what I find amazing is that the Apostle Paul appeals to us to look at prayer through the ways in which we have our accent, our dialect, it's called in the Greek, and that we are all called to be praying for all people. You see, what we know this to be called is intercessory prayer. And it has dialects. It has accents. I will never forget that my first year being on the North Shore, north of Boston by about 45 minutes, was worlds apart from Boston proper. You would hear different dialects and accents, and depending where you'd go, you'd hear English differently. And here I was, first year in New England, coming from West Texas after a decade, via Houston, where I was born. And what amazed me was how fast they were talking. I did not recognize my own language immediately, depending on where I went on the North Shore. And I had a favorite little place, quick place you could get a great sandwich. Sub shops were very popular and still are. But these sub shops had these kind of delicious sandwiches known as Philadelphia steak sandwiches. And now they don't like to claim that the North Shore can do that, but it was fantastic beef that's seasoned. And you have provolone cheese that's melted over it with grilled onions and mushrooms and on a sub bread. It was excellent. You would just think about it, and it would make your mouth water. And I lived in an area that everybody else knew how to pronounce the town, but Peabody is not Peabody. And I would always trip over it and say, Peabody, and they just look at you like you were from another country. It's like, who are you? And if you'd show up at the sub shop, and you weren't prepared to order what you needed, and you weren't listening well, you weren't going to hear the individual serving those sandwiches and wanted to dress the sandwich just so, and you had people behind you, and you needed to have your act together. Well, coming from West Texas, things moved a little slower. And I can tell you, as I heard them say, there were some cars parked right on the side beside the shop on the curb, and the owner of the shop quickly yelled, he goes, "Who has the car, Bob?" And I was like, what did he just say? Who has the car on the curb? I was like, wow, our R's are dropped in Boston area. The car far from that, hey? Did you hear what I said? The car is not far from where it is, hey? And if you're a Mainer, they go up, the dialect and the melody. It always has a nice little ending. Well, we Texans and twangs, we don't have them now, do we? I just want to remind us, let's be truthful, because we, even though we might be born in Houston, and yes, there are studies on dialects and accents, and what I find fascinating is that dialects and accents are different in Houston, right? depending where you live, and depending on how your profession is and what school you go to, and depending on how you're hearing. I find that the twang of West Texas taught me very quickly that there were beautiful, drawn-out, melodic twangs from East Texas, kind of soft and rolls, and from West Texas, it was a twang that was nasal and hard and slow but fast at the same time. Maybe you haven't heard any of those. I can remember one of my cousins saying, well, we're sitting here and having quick order, and what do you want? And I was like, sitting and getting, okay. You know, we have our drop-offs of our consonants and the ways that the twang hits, and I appreciate that there are studies that say only a third now have a twang in Texas. There are studies that look at the impact of technology upon the way we learn language. And the fascinating part to this is the twang that's already always marked Texas, it is diminishing. Some may be sad about it. Some may say, oh, thank goodness. Others may say, well, you know, it didn't really matter. Some of the Texas sayings that I grew up with and some of the ways that you might resonate with. What about the saying of letting the cat out of the bag is a whole lot easier than putting it back in? Or what about the other one of if you're thinking you're a person of some influence, try ordering somebody else's dog around. Now, that's a West Texan expression. Another one, never kick a cow chip on a hot day. Don't squat with your spurs on. Now, some of you may think, I've never ridden a horse. I have no clue about this. Or the other expression, it doesn't take a genius to spot a goat in a flock of sheep. And always drink upstream from the herd. I heard that one. That was an actual statement. And riding horses and on a ranch, you understand that. Never miss a good chance to shut up. That was one in my family that ran. But I find today we come to a passage that Paul is so intentional with preparing Timothy for leadership. And it all begins with prayer. And understanding, my friends, the dialect of intercessory prayer. That's what verses 1 through 7 is about today. There are different types of prayers. And within prayer types, there is specific direction for intercessory prayer. Did you know that? Do you know what intercessory prayer is? See, I think when we think about prayer, we think it starts with me, moi. I have needs, I have hurts, I have concerns. Oh God, please listen to me. And we shoot those arrows, prayers up as fast as we can say them, don't we? We're frustrated. We have needs, we have worries, we move. And then we have prayers of praise, and we try to center ourselves thinking of who God is and lifting up our adoration and learning the word of God, where we lift up and praise God for being a just and loving and true and all-powerful being that has shaped and created this incredible creation we're a part of. Multi-universe, multi-levels that the Webb telescope continues to shock us. Did you see the most recent slides, photos of how stars and planets are formed? And with great detail, we can see the beginning of universes. Friends, our technology is amazing. When we give praise to God and who God is, we need to be learning about creation. It is vast, and it is powerful, and it is beautiful, and it leaves us feeling so small with such grandeur. See, but then there's prayers for others. This is intercessory prayer. But what's even more amazing is that the Apostle Paul in chapter 2 to Timothy, who's just starting out as a young leader, he is being given great care by Paul to say, this is how leadership and the church is to be about daily prayer. And it doesn't begin with where I think it should. It begins with the more challenging, harder part to prayer, where we are praying for all people. Is that on our hearts and minds every day? Honestly, Aren't we relational? We pray for those that we know and we care for, and those that we know who are struggling, and for those that we so have an appreciation for, and for those possibly we struggle with. But do we pray for all people at all time? It's an incredible privilege, and it's an incredible command that Paul lays out here for Timothy. And it's for all leaders. It's not just for one or two people who have a heart to pray. It's not for that pastor. It's not for that elder who said yes. It is for all believers to be praying for all God's people every day, every hour, every way that the Spirit moves us, and praying for God's creation. It is a tall order. And there is literally, in the study of verses 1 through 7, intercessory prayer has four reasons why we're called to pray this way. And Paul lays it out for Timothy. They're called accents of intercessory, dialects of intercessory. Have you heard of that? Just like how we speak, there are nuances to prayers that are focused in specific ways. And what's so beautiful here, Paul lists them so quickly. It's so a part of his language, right? He starts off verses 1 and 2, and he says, we pray for all people, because it is God's delight. It pleases God. We are to pray for all people because it is a request from God, secondly. We pray for all God's people because it is the general way we as believers, as followers of God, are to go every day. And fourthly, we pray for all peoples because in that prayer, we recognize God at work, and it fills you with gratitude. It gives your heart a lift. It gives your mind an awe. It gives you, as you look out at Webb telescope photos, that lifting up of how creation is happening. Prayer does that when you are praying for all God's people. Are we experiencing that grandeur, that excitement? Are we understanding that when Paul says to Timothy, he's so clearly saying, as you are praying this way, gratitude, thanksgiving flows forth through the Holy Spirit working in your life because you're a part of things, my friends. And what are you a part of? As you are praying for all God's people, we are praying for their salvation. We believe in the power of transformation. We believe and are guided by God's truth, the power of truth working in each of our lives. We are a part of creation in our prayer lives. And my friends, churches that pray this way change the world. Churches and communities that commit this way understand the power and grandeur of prayer. Communities of faith that enter into prayer collectively, not just a few leaders, not just one or two who take the time to represent the whole. Each individual member understand these dialects, these accents of intercessory prayer. They understand it is instrumental for how the church grows. They understand it's instrumental for how the salvation of the good news goes forth. It begins with prayer. It's wrapped in prayer. And the Spirit works through the power of the saints. Do we believe? Do we want to enter into that prayer journey? Because it's a journey. It's just not making a few times of intercessory prayer for our family. It's just not, and that's important. The beauty of how Timothy's been prayed for by Paul has allowed Timothy to grow. And the same for Paul, why he's in jail, incarcerated, giving this direction, having hope to continue to live his faith in very hard times. Intercessory prayer for each other is beautiful as believers. But this is focused on all God's people. Some have argued that 1 Timothy chapter 2 is really talking about the church. No, my friends, it is talking about the world. See, we in our prayer commitment are critical for salvation to go forth. Have you ever thought about that? Yes, God sovereignly works in and through, but we are blessed to be the instruments. We matter in our prayer life. We matter in how we're praying, where we're going on FM 1464. It matters that each of us are committed to pray for the larger community that we're in every day. And you know what's fascinating, and I don't like, when I look at where Paul takes them in intercessory prayer for the prayers of all people, where does he begin? When we pray for all people, he starts with leadership. He starts with the key leaders, specifically the rulers of our secular setting. And what are we supposed to pray for? Peace. A quiet life. It's a beautiful metaphor that we believe God has the power through God's truth to bring harmony in the midst of those who believe and don't believe, in the midst of the multi ways in which people are seeking truth. Our prayers influence. Do we believe it? I think we get frustrated. I think if we're real honest, we pray for the leaders we like, and the leaders we're in not alignment with, the leaders we don't like, we don't pray. If we get real honest, we are commanded here to pray for all leaders, secular leaders, and then pray for the larger world we're a part of, for all people. And you know what's even more amazing to me? That we know 1 Timothy was written to the larger community in Ephesus, that as Paul is reaching out to Timothy and he is growing in his leadership, they are up against a multi-religious, multi-faith, multi-God, not monotheistic belief system. The Roman Empire was aggressively pushing the agenda of a polytheistic, worshiping, driven culture. And the Christian culture, Paul just puts it out there so beautifully. Verses 1 through 3, he says, we need to be in intercessory prayer. And then fourthly, in verse 4, he says, it is for our leaders, our secular leaders, and it is for peace. It is for a quiet life, for harmony. And the term peace means one of liberty and freedom for all. It's not just, oh, I want to have an internal sense of order. It is relational. It is political. It is economics. It is race and gender. It is a powerful prayer for equity. See, we in second chapter of 1 Timothy, the Roman Empire was incredibly diverse, and Paul was stepping into it, and he was calling Timothy to say, pray in these ways and teach all those who follow Christ to be of this path, and it will produce mighty works. And ultimately praying for the salvation of all to know the one God, not the polytheistic system they were a part of, the one true triune God. And how do you pray for this? Through the power of the Holy Spirit, he states, and through the one mediator, Jesus Christ. And he states even further in verses 4 through 6, he says, Jesus is the ransom for all. Jesus has been given his life, and the term ransom means a precious gift that others might have life. It's a beautiful expression that we just sung and we've heard read. Christ is the ransom, not just for me, not just for you, but for all, my friends. And even though we may not see the results, even though we may have our judgments on the system, God is at work. It even becomes more developed. Paul theologically has a way to do this masterfully. He moves right into the point of questioning in our minds. God is working through all truth. It is a universal appeal for how prayer changes lives, and that Christ is the one for all. And even in the midst of systems that deny it, God is faithfully and sovereignly at work. You know, when I had to take time to read the Institutes, John Calvin was a powerful thinker on the providence and sovereignty and the doctrine of grace and the singularity of how Christ is the ransom for all life. Because, see, we understand in our own merit, we will fail. In our own efforts, even as we espouse religious faith, we will fail. And even as we in our all our efforts. It's through the mediator, Jesus Christ, that gives us a new nature, love, faith, hope, peace, truth, power, salvation. It is only through Christ, the Redeemer, the Mediator, the perfect ransom. We each here have our ways that we have experienced the power of prayer, have we not? See, the priority of prayer is a beautiful petitioning here that Paul asserts that all believers have a duty and all believers are privileged. Do we feel that privilege or do we feel it more as a burden? See, as the beauty of the children said this morning, we're just talking to God. We are. And now we're directed, as we are talking to God, we are directed to be talking to God about all God's people for their salvation, for their healing, for their completeness, for truth to reign. Actually, the language is powerful because it says, above all, Paul stresses, prayer should be made for everyone. There is a power in our dialects. There is a way in which we each here experience how prayer is at work in our own lives. Maybe you resonate with this description of prayer. Prayer is made of attention. It is the direction towards God of all the attention that the soul is capable of. The quality of the attention makes for much of the quality of the prayer. It cannot be replaced by the heart's warmth. This is a bold statement of not just human endeavor, but pray for your leaders. Pray for the political, international realities we're all a part of. Look what happened in Taiwan. Look what's happened in the power of how Pakistan has moved through and they're flooding. Look at the ways in which we look at the influx of migration that's happening from Central and South America. Look at the ways in which we, in a continent, as we come from such strong connection to Africa and the power of those countries and the battle and the love and the commitment of our members here and the guards of salvation to all. And look at the ways in which in Europe, as Ukraine is dealing with their own continued efforts to be at peace, and we can pray for God to be at work in the power of the ways that are expressed for commitment to leadership. What a beautiful expression has been experienced for the first time, an unprecedented way of from 15 to 24 hours that people are waiting in a 5-mile line to go and show their appreciation for 70 years of leadership through Queen Elizabeth II. They now say it's averaging around 15 hours. It started in a way in which, friends, they've never seen anything like it, of the way people have come to give witness to the 70 years. You see, that commitment to leadership is the same commitment we're called to in our prayer life, praying for our leaders. We recognize the serious and the implications when we do not. Also, another statement about prayer. Prayer comes to pass when we forget ourselves. Perhaps our society's increasing focus on the self and our inability to pray are related. Rabbi Heschel. And another statement on prayer. As we concentrate on each quiver of self-regard, we push away the self-forgetfulness that is central to prayer. So in contrast to all the places that propose to help you to realize yourself, fulfill yourself, celebrate yourself, perhaps our motto should be, forget yourself and pray. Friends, there's so much more that I could say and that we've all read about prayer, but we need to hear the words from the way the Apostle Paul speaks to Timothy. Pray for all God's people. Pray for creation. It is dependent upon our prayers. Through our mediator, our ransom, may it be Jesus Christ. Amen. Join me in prayer.
Mighty, holy, sovereign God, we utter that through grace alone do we have salvation and grace alone do we pray. Teach us to be those who pray for all God's people. In the name and power and life of Christ Jesus, we pray. Amen.
Responding to God's word, prayers of the people. Let's pray. God, our Savior, to lift our prayers to you is good and the means by which we receive strength, healing, and peace. We pray for those who are struggling and lost. We pray for those who are ill and downtrodden. And we pray for liberation from all who seek to oppress rather than love and empower. We pray for those who are in positions of authority, for truth and justice to guide them. We pray to be followers to grow in our capacity to share and to respond to the financial needs around us. May we, as your people, be known as generous responders and great givers with the capacity to change lives through being responsible and gracious stewards of our gift, both financially and spiritually. You have taught us through Christ that we can serve only one. We commit our allegiance to you alone as we pray together, now as Christ taught his disciples to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Let us give our tithes and offerings as an expression of our commitment to pray for all God's people, and pray for these gifts to be used in a myriad of ways for the needs that we live in and amongst, and trust the power that giving changes lives through the power of prayer, through the power of giving.
Ah!
Friends, as we go forth, may we remember these words. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord be kind and gracious to you. May the Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen. Amen.
And be gracious unto you.